was it yesterday afternoon or an afternoon before, so it should be good.
There it is.
Yep, I'm already streaming at 2200 kilobytes a second, so I'm good.
Volume, God, we're at 192.
Everything with my internet seems to have cleared up because I did a speed test last night and it's up to where it's supposed to be.
Congrats on the top 10 placement.
Oh, thanks.
By the way, sorry I didn't get to watch any of the stream because trivia went a little bit later than I had expected, but
oh, that's okay.
I saw that you placed in the top 10, so that's great.
Yeah, I thought man, I'm tired. I thought I was good. I was hoping I could stick to that sixth place, but two of the runners on Sunday knocked me down to eighth place.
But still, placing in the top 10 is not bad at all.
Yeah, it's not bad. I'm proud of it. You know, if you'd have asked me a year ago if I'd be able to beat Ninja Gaiden in under an hour, I would have said you were crazy.
But still, I think that's top 10 of anything to me is not bad at all.
Oh, yeah. Stream looks good. All right. I'm going to close that out.
Tweak your picture just a little bit.
You're putting this out to Facebook?
Yeah, I'm going to stream it to Facebook. I just got to do one more thing real quick.
Are you still using regular OBS, or did you get that Streamlabs?
I haven't had a chance yet. I've been pretty slammed the last couple of weeks.
Dude, I'm telling you, it makes life so much simpler. And it'll port over all your OBS settings, too, whenever you download it. It'll just automatically pull it all over.
Yeah, next weekend will finally be some time that I have to take a break because I have to work on Saturday. And then Sunday, I'm helping my parents out with a few things. And then Monday, I have my fantasy football draft. And then Tuesday is, back to work.
Yeah.
So,
dude, this weekend, I think this is my first weekend, completely off in, a month or two. And I'm so looking forward to just doing absolutely nothing.
Oh, I bet. No, it's nice. All right.
Let me know when you're ready, because I've got everything pulled up and ready to go.
How in Discord? How do I get rid of my little window?
Discord,
next to you, or is there?
Usually, what I do is, you see where the chat is there at the bottom. If you there's a button right to the left of the turn on and turn off camera. There's a down arrow, and I hit that, and that brings up kind of a it takes the chat away. And then picture, it'll say hide members.
Okay.
Or on mine, it'll say hide members.
All right.
Because I'm looking at you and it says hide members on yours.
All right, let's see. Hide members. I'm not seeing that.
I should be the biggest picture there in your little...
You are.
Field there.
Okay, there we go. All right, I got it. I got it. Cool. All right,
I don't know. It might be different on Windows, but on mine, it's a little arrow to the right.
All right, that's much better. Now we're pretty much even. All right, let me lock that. Start streaming. Pull this up. And then I will record it on my end as well, just in case.
Sweet.
Hit record. Let me go live on Facebook. And I've got all my tabs open and everything, so
all right.
I am all set when you are.
Awesome.
And we are streaming on the Facebook.
Sweet. Screw Facebook. All right.
I mean, I pretty much use it just to promote stuff now.
Yeah, same here. I'm still thinking about just deactivating my account.
I don't think you'd miss anything.
No, I've been off Facebook for a month. I haven't even looked on it. And you know what? I don't miss it at all. And I've been building up my Twitter pretty good in the meantime. So that's a plus. All right. Well, if you're ready, I'm ready.
I'm ready.
Here we go. Do you like this show and you want to help support us? Do you want us to stay ad-free? Do you want extra episodes every month? Of course you do. Then head over to patreon.com/nerdcaveretro. Become a Patreon supporter of this very show. Programs and welcome to another edition of the Nerd Cave Retro Show. My name is Jason Robbins.
And my name is Derek Diamond.
And we already got a lively little chat room right now. What's up, Mixmaster Joey Image and I Am The Rampage. And Joey says, check out that new addition to the wall behind me. And if you'll look right up here, I have a Super Mario Brothers 3. Looks like a little, almost like a bus or a... like a little van, the Super Mario Brothers 3 van.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, Joey that's sent really that to cool. me. I got it in the mail yesterday. So thank you, Mr. Image, for that.
Yeah.
Little new addition awesome. To the wall. So it's been a few weeks since we've been here for a live episode. It feels, feels like it's been forever.
Yeah, we were talking before we went live. I thought to myself, well, I remembered how to hit the accept call button.
Yeah.
So we're off to a good start, so... I think, you know, we'll shake the rust off. But no, it's been cool though to do a couple of, you know, non-traditional episodes, like we did the Ninja Turtles roundtable last week, which was a lot of fun. Mm-hmm. We did the Street Fighter commentary, which those are always fun to do. But good to be back in the saddle for a traditional Nerd Cave Retro.
Oh yeah. So what you been doing the last couple of weeks?
I've actually been really busy with work. We're kind of transitioning back into, I guess, as close to what normal can be right now. We're next week, everyone's going back into the office. I think we're probably going to scale down on the events that we've been doing, because we've been doing, you know, like bingo and game show nights every week, in addition to trivia that I've been hosting. We've been doing movie nights on Saturdays, but those are starting to get scaled back now. So yeah. I think I'd say the end of October, we'll probably be doing maybe one, two events a month, and then kind of prepping for, you know, the uncertainty still of what could be the 2021 baseball season, at least for us, because yeah. We don't even have a schedule yet.
Well, it's the slow ascent back to somewhat normalcy, I guess. So
yeah,
we'll see.
Yeah, I would say so. Yeah, but other than that, been got some cool things in the works for my show. I've been, you know, started the Patreon a couple of weeks ago, and that's been pretty successful so far, and got some cool guests lined up over the next couple of weeks, and hope to do kind of what we've been doing here on this show, where we've been doing like Halloween Horror Month, where we review horror themed games. I might try and do like horror themed episodes throughout October on my show as well. So got that to look forward to.
Yeah. Before I forget, I want to tell everybody about a new podcast I've been listening to, and it's by Sawilo Films, who was the production team that did Monsters Anonymous. And it stars Brent Henry, who was the Wolfman in Monsters Anonymous, and was also like pretty much the head of our production team, putting everything together for Monsters Anonymous. And it's called Astro Trash. It's a 6-episode sci-fi comedy podcast, and it's a scripted podcast. So, and it's very, very well made, high production. I just go listen to the first episode and see if it's up your alley type of, if it's something you'd be into. I love it. I think it's great. And we're going to have Brent on the Open Micers podcast at the end of September. So go check that out. It's Astro Trash Podcast and Astro www.trash.com. And it's really good.
I will check that out.
Another thing, if anybody got to see, I was a part of the RGB High Score tournament last week. And the last couple of weeks of my life have been spent speed running Ninja Gaiden. And I ended up in eighth place overall with a 22:22 personal best time. And I actually got robbed. If you go watch my entire stream, which you don't have to, it's 2 hours that I did Friday night for the tournament. One of my runs, the ones I did after the 22:22, I was robbed of a 17-minute run. I could have been in like fourth place, but I was robbed. That game was actively against me the entire night. There was, 25 people, I think, in the tournament. And it was like 2 to 3 people a night, and then I think there were 4 people on Saturday and 5 on Sunday. So it was a complete entire week of Ninja Gaiden for the RGB High Score. And I want to keep doing it. As much as that game gave me nightmares for 2 straight weeks, I think I can pull off being a part of the knockout tournament next year with Arcus, who is the world record speedrunner for Ninja Gaiden. I want to at least, if I can end in the top 5 of those guys with the retro runner, Beer Full of Belly, Arcus, those guys, and gals. There are women Ninja Gaiden speedrunners who are very, very good. And go check all those people out on Twitch. They're crazy good. But if I can end up in the top 5 of those, I'll know that I'm in the top tier players in the world. And I think I can get there. I think I'm good enough to get there.
It's been really cool to see, because I remember watching you beat that game for the first time a few months ago.
Mm-hmm.
And now you're placing in the top 10 of speedruns. So that's fantastic. Congratulations.
Thanks, man. It was definitely hard fought to get to that 22-minute mark.
I'm sure. But still, we were talking before, placing in the top 10 of anything, especially something like that, is wherever you place is impressive.
Yeah.
So that's awesome.
I wish I could have kept that number 6 spot, but... Yeah, I got knocked down to 8. But yeah, Mixmaster says I need to speedrun Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. That is the plan. I have been trying to get good enough at that game I can start speedrunning it. Because the key to speedrunning is just memorization. Knowing where everything's going to be, what enemies you can avoid, what power-ups you need to get, what power-ups drop where. I mean, that's the key to speedrunning. So once I get Ninja Gaiden, Ninja Turtles, and Batman, once I can get those games memorized, I'm going to be very, very heavily on speedrunning those 3 games.
I would love to watch you do a speedrun for TMNT.
Oh, I'm going to do it. I mean, that game is not easy. The cool thing about Ninja Gaiden is it's pretty predictable. It's just, it's stupid hard. And the hard thing about Ninja Turtles is that game... isn't the same every time you play it, so it's harder to speedrun.
Mm-hmm.
But I love that game so much, I just want to be able to speedrun it at this point. If I can just get past the room. The room! Danmu, the room!
The room.
But I don't know about you, it's been a while since we've done some news. What do you say we move into that now?
Sure.
From NintendoLife.com, believe the hype, Polymega is the ultimate all-in-one retro machine. Originally announced back in 2017 as the RetroBlox, Polymega has endured a fairly tumultuous journey to market. The system's objective has always been the same, to offer players the chance to access software for a wide range of cartridge and CD-based retro game consoles in one place. This is a long article. I'm just trying to get the basics of it. Hold on. This is a huge article. The base Polymega system is $399. Comes with a CD drive and will play Sega Saturn, Sony PlayStation, Sega Mega CD, Neo Geo CD, and PC Engine TurboGrafx-16 games from CD games from all regions. Cartridge-based platforms, Nintendo, Super Nintendo, Mega Drive, 32X, and PC Engine, TurboGrafx-16 will be playable using an optional element module, each of which has to be purchased separately at a cost of $79.99 and come with their own custom controllers based on the pads used in the original machines. The element modules also house controller ports for their respective systems, so you can use original controllers if you have them in hand. Output is HDMI and pushes a nice crisp 1080p signal to your HD television. It has a 9GB pre-installed database, which has cover art, text descriptions, and screenshots for thousands of supported games all across the systems. There was one more thing I wanted to read here. Let's see if I can find it. I know it because it said something about Wi-Fi, and I'm trying to find it in the article here. Supports a wide range of wired and 2.4 gigahertz pads. Let's see. God, this is such a large article. I know I read it here somewhere, but it's definitely Wi-Fi capable. I can't find it, but it does, like I said, it is Wi-Fi capable. This thing is, like, I read this article, like, man, this thing is just such a badass when it comes to retro games. I mean, I don't know if I could justify dropping $400 for this thing, but if you are interested and if you want to get into retro gaming and you don't, like, because I've paid way more than this on just old consoles and games and stuff like that, you would do well to just get this and build from there. And because you're going to be able to play it on HD televisions. You pretty much play anything you want on it that's retro. I mean, the Sega CD stuff, you know, even like TurboGrafx-16 stuff. I mean, this thing plays everything. So why would you not? If you were interested in getting into retro gaming, this is probably the thing you'd want to get.
Yeah, I would agree. And the more you talk about this, I vaguely remember us discussing it when it was the Retro Blocks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because that name sounds very familiar. But it would be something, yeah, $400 is a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
But if you think about just the amount of stuff that you can do,
mm-hmm.
I personally think it's worth it. I don't know that I will personally get one, but if someone gets it and they're a diehard retro gaming fan, like, I wouldn't knock them for it.
Yeah, I wouldn't either. I would actually be like, can I see it? Can I play it?
Yeah, just the sheer amount of stuff you can do with it, I think, justifies the price tag. And you look at, you know, and you think back to just the stuff that you just listed,
mm-hmm.
I think it's worth it.
And I think, too, if you're a heavy streamer, this is something you'd want to get too. Like, this is a perfect.
Oh, absolutely.
This is the perfect console for a streamer to be able to play everything in 1080, everything from NES all the way up to, you know, PlayStation and Sega Saturn. Like, it's just this. It's a no-brainer if that's what you want to do.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, I didn't even think about that. Yeah, no, this would be perfect for streaming.
Mm-hmm. And it looks nice, too. Like, I really like the look of this thing. It's got a modern but still sort of retro look to it. It's weird.
I'm a big fan of very clean-looking mm-hmm. technology. And this is, like, it has a little bit of a pattern, you know, across the side of it where it says Polymega. But other than that, it's just simple black looking system.
You know what it looks like to me? If the original Xbox was made in the 80s. That's
yes.
what it looks like to me.
But with a much better controller.
Yeah, much, much better.
Not one that's like the size of my head.
Yeah, canned ham. That's what me and Wally used to call it, the canned ham.
The canned ham. I like that. Let's see. Our next story comes to us from The Verge. .com. Nintendo reportedly releasing upgraded Switch next year. Nintendo is planning to release an upgraded version of its popular Switch game console next year, according to reports in Taiwan's Economic Daily News and Bloomberg. The new model will come out in early 2021, according to the Economic Daily News, which cited supply chain sources. This could be the first serious performance upgrade to the Switch since its release in March of 2017. Bloomberg says Nintendo has looked into including more computing power and 4K high-definition graphics, while the Economic Daily News mentions improved visuals. Nintendo did release two new Switch models last year, but they used a more power-efficient version of the original hardware to enable a smaller form factor and better battery life without notable performance improvements. So what do you think? You think Nintendo is due for a upgraded Switch?
You know, I'll be honest. I mean, I'm still completely happy with my original Switch. I don't have any reason to go and buy a newer model, but I think if you haven't, you know, if you've worn your Switch out and need more space, or, you know, I don't know, if maybe you don't, I don't know, like if you don't have a Switch yet and you haven't pulled the trigger on like a Mini or something like that, not the Mini, but what do they call it? The Lite, Switch Lite.
Yep.
I would think, you know, I would wait for this to come out, because it's probably going to be roughly the same price as the Switch when it first came out. But, I mean, we're far enough into the console cycle now that I think Nintendo's probably going to come out with a new console within the next, what, I'd say by 2023, they're probably going to have a new console, probably announce it in early 2022, maybe. So we're not that far off from a new console.
That would put the Switch life cycle at about 6 years, which, yeah, you know, 5 or 6 years is about right. Some have gone a little bit longer, but I remember back in the day it was like a solid 5 years.
Yeah.
Because I remember the GameCube came out in 2001, and I think 2006 was when the Wii came out. Mm-hmm. And then it might have been 96 when the 64 came out. Don't quote me on that, but it was like 95, 96.
Yeah, I mean, we're well over. I would say right now we're well over the halfway point for the life of the Switch at this point.
And there's still, and the article mentions too, that there's other, you know, big titles that are still, you know, in the wings, you know, with the Breath of the Wild sequel. If Metroid ever happens, we'll see.
Yeah. Well, since they just put out that press release that they need team leader, project leader to get it back on track.
Like project manager, something like that.
Oh, we're still a good 2 years away at least.
I mean, who knows? It might be at that point one of the last big games for the Switch.
Joey Emmons said he saw a dude in Scotland on Twitter selling a complete in-box version of the Panasonic GameCube Q. That's weird.
That sounds so familiar.
Yeah.
I'll have to look that up. But no, that sounds familiar.
Also from NintendoLife.com, another Sega double pack for the Nintendo Switch has been spotted online. Hasn't been officially confirmed by Sega. Amazon has now seemingly revealed the double pack box art for Super Monkey Ball, Banana Blitz HD, and Sonic Forces. Spotted by Tails Channel, Gamefly has a listing on Sonic Forces and a Super Monkey Ball HD double pack. Let's see. It said the release date was the 31st of October. Gamefly has a relatively good track record when it comes to Nintendo Switch listings. It revealed Titan Quest and Mutant Year Zero were both on their way to the system ahead of any official announcements. So what do you think about the two-pack Super Monkey Ball and Sonic Forces? I don't remember how you felt about Sonic Forces.
So from what little I've seen of it, I've never actually played the game. I heard very, very mixed things, but that's kind of the MO of the modern 2D, 3D hybrid Sonic games.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's a good idea to pack it in with another game, because I know there are people who like Super Monkey Ball. I played that series briefly, and I don't dislike it. I just never really gotten into it. I personally probably won't get it, but I don't think it's a terrible idea to package the two games together, because I remember Sonic Forces critically was not very well received. That's the one where you can create your own character.
Oh, yeah.
You play as your own character along with Sonic.
So, I never played it. I know a lot of people have a lot of nostalgia for Super Monkey Ball.
Mm-hmm.
So that might be something people will jump on. And yeah. Joey Image said that it was the GameCube Panasonic DVD player combo unit. Super expensive and wasn't around long.
That's right.
It sounds familiar, but I don't think I ever saw one.
I remember reading about it, but I never really saw one, you know, in action.
Yeah, I didn't either. This next story is right up your alley, though. For the next story, I figured you'd like this.
Puma, oh, this is from NintendoLife.com. Puma looks ready to pounce on Super Mario's 35th anniversary with some Nintendo-branded sneakers. Now, I will say I have not read this yet, so you're going to get my like immediate reaction.
Yeah,
in recent years, we've seen sportswear giant Puma getting in on the Vidya game action. I love that they put that word. With various crossovers. A couple of years back, there was a line of Sonic-styled sneakers, and last year, the company teamed up with the Tetris company for a fetching line of Tetris-based footwear, more comfortable than you might imagine given that particular crossover. Now it seems that Puma and Nintendo are getting together for a similar Mario crossover, no doubt as a tie-in for the plumber's upcoming 35th anniversary. As reported by Press Start, a pair of Super Mario sneakers, or trainers as we say around these parts, appeared on Foot Locker's website. The product page has since been taken down, but not before the internet got a good look at the red and blue footwear. Let me click on this link here.
Let me take a look at these. Ah, oh, the tweet is unavailable.
Oh, boo.
Boo.
That's unfortunate. I would love to see what they look like. I'll say this. Like, I've never really owned... I've never owned Puma shoes.
Oh, I did when I was a kid. That's all I had was Pumas. That's all we could afford. Pumas were the cheap shoes when I was a kid. That was the Kmart brand when I was a kid.
I'm not knocking Puma at all. Like, I've just never owned a pair.
Yeah.
They should have made the legit Sonic sneakers from the movie.
Oh, yeah.
I would have bought a pair in a heartbeat.
You know what?
I
hope these...
It would have been a dangerous purchase because I likely would have, like, just taken a glance at the price tag. Like, nope, gotta have them.
I hope these look a lot better than those Nintendo 64 shoes that got put out a while back. Those were not great looking. I mean, they were okay, but you couldn't tell that they were Nintendo 64 sneakers. Like, they had the colors, but they weren't really... I don't know, they didn't scream Nintendo 64, you know? It was kind of, meh. All right.
You want to know something I've noticed? That the Super Nintendo... So, like, Nintendo's released certain merchandise over the years. I mean, they've gotten a lot better about it. The Super Nintendo based merchandise is some of the ugliest looking merchandise I've ever seen. Well, so like I don't know if you've ever been in the store called Box Lunch.
Mm-mm.
So it's like a nerd pop culture store. We have one here in our mall and they have a little Nintendo section. That's where I got that Majora's Mask Hawaiian shirt that I posted the Discord a couple of weeks ago. They had this long-sleeve Super Nintendo shirt. You know, like that ugly, like, kind of light gray that the console is? That the mm-hmm. shirt was that color and just said Super Nintendo down one of the sleeves. And I'm like, you've got to be kidding me.
Yeah.
who printed that and said it was a good idea?
I was laughing because Joey Image put in the chat room, I'd buy Sonic shoes even if they were like $2,000 if they make you run as fast as Sonic.
I would too.
I would too. I got $2,000 ready to go for some super powered shoes.
Man, seriously, like if Puma had made those shoes, I would have bought them in a heartbeat and I would wear them every day.
You know, I think if they'd have known that Sonic was going to be as big as it was, they would have. But that was a gamble, you know?
Well, I think they could do it for when the sequel comes out.
Oh, yeah.
In a couple of years.
If they don't, that's a missed opportunity.
Absolutely.
And for our last story, we save the best for last. The Mandalorian Season 2 release date revealed. This came on IGN.com. Second season will officially be released on Disney Plus on October 30th, 2020. Came from Twitter with some new title art of the Mandalorian himself and the child, and the words, "This is the day. New episodes start streaming October 30th. And let's see. The last episode was on December 27th, which feels like a lifetime ago, doesn't it?
I mean, it was another lifetime. That was pre-COVID.
So, but the last person we saw was Giancarlo Esposito's Moff Gideon, as he's cutting out of the TIE interceptor with the dark saber, which I know I'm spoiling it, but if you're listening to this and you haven't seen The Mandalorian, what are you doing? I don't give a shit about spoiling it for you. You just go watch it. It's one of the best things ever.
I've said this before, and I may have said this on the show, but I know I've told you this off air. This, to me, was the best Star Wars property since Return of the Jedi.
Yeah, absolutely.
And to me, it's not even close. This show is so damn good.
I can't wait.
From the very beginning, like, I love that shot from the very beginning when Mando walks into that bar, and it's like you're straight out of a Western.
Yeah. Just thinking about it makes me want to go watch it right now.
I'm going to watch the whole series again before this premieres. And this is one that, if this is available, like, for me to watch before I have to go into work that day, I will wake up early to watch it. Like, that's how much I'm looking forward to it.
I almost bought a Baby Yoda, the child, in Best Buy the other day. They had them, the life-size ones. They were really nice, so, like, the hard plastic, you know, heads and everything. It was like $20. I was like, I want it so bad, but I can't justify dropping $20 on this for no reason.
Does it do the magic hand thing?
Well, it's got the little hands. You could put his hands up and do the magic hands. Baby, do the magic hand.
This is going to just show my maturity on my part, but anytime I see one of those in a store, especially if I'm with somebody, I'll pick it up, and then I'll grab its hand, and I'll just make it do the magic hand thing.
Oh, and Mixmaster said that Supernatural has resumed filming. Awesome. I still got to get caught up. I'm still like half a season behind at this point.
It is nuts how like long that show has been going.
What is it, like, absolutely 15 seasons?
Jensen Ackles, I remember he was on the early seasons of Smallville, and when his character was killed off was when they started Supernatural.
Oh,
and
yeah.
It's been going ever since.
Thing is, I think Supernatural started in, what, like 2004, 2005? I was still on the road with Fall as well when that show was started. And that feels like a different life ago. And that's when that show started. I was on the road with the band at that point.
I would have either been graduating or I just graduated high school when that show started. And Mixmaster, they completed filming of Mandalorian before the COVID pandemic. So all they had to do was post work, which,
Seen the technology that they use for, like, it's not green screen, it's like not rear projection, but it's like that, it's like they're in a bubble, but it's like
there's a technical name for it, but I can't remember, because they talk about it in the gallery on Disney Plus, which I recommend anybody watch if you're a fan of The Mandalorian.
It's so cool. Ah, that show's so good. I can't wait.
That is going to change the way that filmmaking is done.
Oh yeah, I would have never known that wasn't like green screen. Like, the thing it was is, I know when you're watching the show, it's like, this feels like a real environment. This doesn't feel like green screen, and it's just the way they light everything, and just it's so cool and crazy. Like, Jon Favreau, just, man, he saved Star Wars. Give that dude the brass ring, man. Let him run everything.
Well, I know they're going to be using that same technology with the Obi-Wan series, which hopefully will be starting soon.
I hope so.
That's one. I get why they want to take their time with it, because the expectations for that series is going to be through the roof.
Yeah, they got a large hill to climb after The Mandalorian.
Well, and I think even season two of Mandalorian is going to have high expectations, you know, because no one really knew what to think with Mandalorian when it was, leading up to its release.
Yeah.
And then it ended up being the huge hit that it has been.
Mix Master said he thinks of him as the dude from Swingers. I love Swingers. That was when I first saw Jon Favreau. And I love the movie Made, too. Have you ever seen Made? It was the movie that he and Vince Vaughn did right after Swingers. It's great. If you guys have never seen Made, go watch that. If you love Swingers, you'll love Made.
It's crazy to think that he went from being an out-of-work actor to, to me, one of the premier filmmakers in the industry.
Not only he started off as an independent filmmaker, like couldn't get a job as an actor anywhere, and now he basically started the entire MCU, and now he's saved Star Wars. Like, the dude is just, he's won. Like, that dude just won everything.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Give that dude everything.
Yeah, no, and I think, you know, that's the route that Star Wars needs to go in the short term, is the 10 to 12 episode series, just because there's so much that you can do in that universe.
Yeah. Oh, I wish they would do like a 12 episode season. I need more. I need more episodes every season.
You're going to see the Disney Plus subscriptions skyrocket again when that show comes out.
Oh, yeah. Well, it is time.
I got to see what happens to Baby Yoda.
Oh, I know. He looks like, and did you see the photos where they said it looks like he's growing because he's actually taller this season? That's going to be cool.
I can't wait.
All right, well, let's move into this month in video game history. In September of 1981, Namco releases Galaga, the sequel to Galaxian, which becomes more popular than the original. Love me some Galaga. We have the big, huge Galaga machine at the local arcade here, the Margaritaville. I love playing that big Galaga machine.
I haven't seen a big Galaga one. I see the big Space Invaders ones a lot. Mm-hmm. Like, any hotel or bar that I go to that has some type of an arcade all have Space Invaders. But Galaga, I mean, Galaga's up there with the most iconic video arcade games of all time.
Yeah, they have they have Galaga, they have the Space Invaders, and they also have the world's largest Pac-Man machine.
I've still got to come down and see that.
Yeah, whenever things open back up.
Yeah, we'll get there. We will get there. On September 24th of 1982, Namco releases Pole Position, one of the first games with stereophonic and quadraphonic sound. Featuring a pseudo-3D third-person rearview perspective, it becomes the most popular racing game of its time.
I love me some Pole Position. I used to play that in the arcade when I was a little kid. I think I had that for Atari, too.
Was this game featured in The Wizard?
No, I don't think so.
No, that was, I think that was RC Pro-Am that was in The Wizard. But I do recognize screenshots.
No, The Wizard was Rad Racer.
Oh, it was Rad Racer?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I remember having a racing game for the Atari, and I thought it was Pole Position, but it's not the arcade version of Pole Position. Or it might have been called something else. I don't remember. But yeah, I did play Pole Position in the arcade.
Unfortunately, I've never played it.
Joey Emmons says Atari, yes. Was it like, I remember it being a top-down view, and you just had one straight track, and all you had to do was go up and down and try to, miss oil slicks and other cars and stuff like that. So if that's the Pole Position I'm thinking of, that was, what a crap port that was. All right, let's see. September 26th of 1986, Konami releases why do I always have to pronounce the Japanese stuff in video game history? Can I just say Japanese word Dracula for the Famicom? Cause, dude, there's all kind of like stuff on the Akumajo Dracula for the Famicom disk system, otherwise known in America as Castlevania.
I don't want to say that was by design, but. dot, dot, dot. No,
I love Castlevania, but if it was called Akumajo Dracula, I probably wouldn't have played it as much.
Playing that fancy Dracula game for the NES. Oh, man. Well, another one that is iconic game for the NES. On September 14th of 1989, Capcom releases DuckTales for the NES based on the Disney animated TV series of the same name. One of the first games reviewed on the show.
Oh, yeah. One of the top 10 best games for the Nintendo.
I really liked playing the remastered version.
I never
played
it. On the
Xbox 360 back in the day. It's good.
I wish they would redo it. This seems like ready-made for the Switch, or, you know, to just, like, that seems like the perfect game to put to re-release it on the Switch. Like, why not? Give it to me. I'd buy it. You don't want my money, Capcom? Why?
That's crazy to think. Why is this game not on the Switch?
I don't know. That's a no-brainer.
I have no idea.
On September 9th of 1995, Rayman is released for the PlayStation. I didn't know Rayman was that old. I thought that came around in, like, PlayStation 2 era.
It was actually a launch title for the PlayStation because the PlayStation 1 launched on the same day.
I didn't even know what the launch title for the PlayStation was. I thought it was, like, Twisted Metal or something.
I don't even know if Crash Bandicoot was the launch title for the PlayStation. I just happened to notice that, you know, when I was combining these together, I was like, huh, I didn't know Rayman was a launch title.
That probably
but, yeah,
just
I'm with you.
My...
I thought Rayman was, you know, might have been like a PlayStation 2 era for the first game, but
I just had, like, Twisted Metal is just, like, tied to PlayStation for me because I think that was one of the first, probably the very first game I ever played for the PlayStation.
I always think of Sweet Tooth.
Yeah, I always played
Twisted
Sweet Tooth.
Metal.
I bet if we go back now and play that, I haven't played that game in probably 22 years at least. Over two decades since I've played Twisted Metal. I used to think it looked so good. I bet if we go back now, it just looks like absolute garbage. Just a garbage pile of polygonal, like, just a mess of polygons.
You should review it at some point.
No, I'd rather leave my memories of playing Twisted Metal with my buddy all night long right where they are, because I know that that era of gaming is just, I think we should just leave it alone.
That's very fair. On September 12th of 1998, Pokemon Yellow is released for the Game Boy in Japan. This was the... It was essentially like started the third version of generational Pokemon games. So in every generation of Pokemon games, so like Gen 1, it started as Red and Blue. Mm. And then Yellow came out because it adapted elements from the anime, which was really popular. So you had Pikachu as your starter Pokemon, and he would follow you around. Because in the show, Pikachu didn't like to be inside the Pokeball. Hmm. And it would incorporate, you know, a couple of more characters from the show. It's essentially the same game. Just characters are redesigned a little bit to reflect the show, which I thought was cool. But that started that trend of, you know, every generation of Pokemon where you'd release the two games that had exclusive versions, you'd have the third one later on. But Pokemon Yellow is still my favorite all-time Pokemon game ever.
Did you see that there was a guy that had a graded, it was like a 9.5 Pokemon Red card? And traded it straight up for a Nintendo World Championship gray cart, I think.
Holy crap.
Yeah.
So I did not know that.
That's easily like a $70,000 video game and just traded a Pokemon card for it. Like, why can't I find something in my collection that's worth $70,000? Like, why?
I'm pretty sure I would break out in sweats making that trade.
I would, too. I'd be like, ugh. Like, I break out in a sweat buying a new car, like, much less, like, and I've never bought a car worth more than 20 grand, you know? So, I don't know. I'd be the same way. My palms would be sweaty. Mom spaghetti.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Next to last one, September 9th of 1999, the Dreamcast is launched in North America with 19 launch titles. Joey, didn't you get a complete inbox Dreamcast not too long ago? I think I tweeted it out, your YouTube video, because Joey had got sent a brand new complete in the box Dreamcast. Like, never opened. like it might have been open, but it still had, like, everything was in there. Like, some brand new games that had never been opened for it. Yeah, it was still factory sealed, and he opened it on the video. Never been opened. Like, I guess somebody send me some stuff like that. But I can't complain. I got my Super Mario Bros. 3 little van up here on the wall that Joey sent me.
Yeah. And to close us out for this month in video game history, on September 20th of 2000, Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 2 is released for the PlayStation, which
love
I believe
Tony Hawk.
Pro Skater 1 and 2 are being remastered.
I know. I can't wait. I love Tony Hawk games.
I love the soundtrack to those games. That's like perfect for like my teenage years when that game came out.
Oh, yeah.
1 and 2.
Oh, and if you want to go see that video of him opening up that that Dreamcast box, go to Joey Image TV on YouTube and give that that video a watch. It's really cool just to watch him open up something that's, you know, 22 years old, 20 years old, and it's never been opened. Like, that's so rare. Like, especially with video game stuff. Like, man, that must have been, like, he did the one thing that I do. I wish he'd have done, like, when you first open, like, electronic stuff. Do you like to just take a big whiff like I do?
I do.
Yeah. Something about that chemical smell is just like,
That new console smell.
Yes. Oh, he did do that in a video. I forgot. So I love that smell. So go check that video out, Joey Image TV. And it was a great video. And, but yeah, I think before we go into the review for tonight, Derek has some shout-outs.
Yeah, so as always, we like to shout out our awesome patrons over at patreon.com/nerdcaveretro. We want to shout out Armez Jackson, Axeblade07, Daniel Salmon, John Jekyll, a.k.a. Mixmaster, Carlos Longoria, Staff Sergeant Sketch, and Randy Bailey. Thank you guys so much for keeping the lights on for us, keeping the Nerd Cave Retro afloat. And because we are at the $50 level still, we will continue to do fun commentary tracks like Street Fighter, like Double Dragon. The movie wasn't great, but the commentary was fun. We've got some cool ones lined up over the next couple of months. I think we're going to do Mortal Kombat fairly soon. We're going to do Mask of the Phantasm, which I'm really excited to do. And, you know, any other ones that you guys would like us to do, just send them our way. And if you want to be a part of our awesome Patreon, head over to patreon.com/nerdcaveretro.
And Derek's going to be talking about
boy, if that's not MIDI music, I don't know what is. I love it. You ever notice Game Boy has a very distinct sound? And I know it's probably because it was a handheld made in 1989, but you listen to a track and you can tell more than likely that it's from a Game Boy game.
You know, the weird thing is that it actually had a more advanced sound chip than the NES had. That's why a lot of people use the Game Boy now for doing, you know, what do they call it? I don't know what they call it.
I know what you're talking about, but I'm blanking on the term.
Yeah, I don't know. Bit composing, like bit music.
For a split second, I thought you were going to say Bitcoin.
Yeah, Bitcoin, like, bit composing, something like that. Yeah. They make music with the Game Boy using the noises. There we go.
So tonight, I'm going to be reviewing, to me, what I think is one of the more underrated platform games for the Game Boy, and that is Wario Land, a.k.a. Super Mario Land 3. It is a platform game developed by Nintendo for the Game Boy in 1994. It's the first game to feature Wario as both a playable character and the main character, as well as the first appearance of Captain Syrup and her brown sugar pirates, who are recurring villains in the Wario Land
that
series.
That sounds delicious.
I know, right? Before the end of the show, remind me to tell my Waffle House story.
Okay.
So Wario Land, you know, I reviewed Mario Land 2 a while back, and that's a fun game all in itself, but the main thing that came from that was the appearance of Wario, because we had never seen almost like an, not necessarily an evil twin, but an evil doppelganger of sorts for Mario. And his popularity really took off, you know, and I was one of those people. I always thought Wario was a really cool character. So I was excited when, and I want to say I read it in Nintendo Power that this game was coming out and it was going to feature Wario. So I thought to myself, this game's obviously going to be good because this is, you know, the heyday of Nintendo when they're firing on all cylinders with platformers and it seems like they can't screw anything up. So this game was released specifically in North America in March of 1994. I don't remember if I got this game immediately when it came out, but I got it fairly soon after. And it's, to me, probably the most fun of the Mario Land trilogy, which is ironic because it doesn't feature Mario. But so essentially how it works is Wario, you collect treasure, which is a recurring theme in Wario games. Wario, yeah, he's the hero in this game, but he's also very greedy and he wants money. It takes place right after Mario Land 2. He's been kicked out of Mario's castle, and he wants to get a castle of his own. So he goes to this island, which is named, let me see if I can find, oh, Kitchen Island. The cool thing is all the areas you go to are themed after food or kitchen-related items, which is it adds kind of a fun element to the game. So essentially what you do is you go through each world, and what you're trying to find at the end of the game is this giant golden statue of Princess Peach that was stolen from the Mushroom Kingdom. So Wario wants to find the statue and basically sell it, you know, to get as much money as he can. But as you progress through the game, you find hidden treasure. And at the end of the game, it essentially counts your total of like treasure you've collected, amount of coins you've collected, because each treasure item is worth a certain amount of coins. And depending on how much money you have is what you get at the end of the game. So if you have next to nothing, I think you get like a birdhouse that has Wario's emblem on it. But you get anywhere between a birdhouse, a normal house, a palace, a castle. But the ultimate thing that you can get, and I actually didn't know this until I was doing more research for the game, if you max out the amount of money you get a planet.
That's cool.
Which I think, with Wario's face on it. And I think that is hilarious.
Says here, even the least valuable treasure is worth roughly as much coins as the player would normally acquire over the entire game.
I don't remember the exact number of treasure items that you can get, but it's a fairly decent amount. And it is some, you know, you have to return to earlier levels after you do something that affects something, you know, that happens earlier in the game. You go back and go through various levels that might be filled with water or might have water drained, where you can go back and find hidden treasure items that you couldn't before. So that's the main objective of the game, and it works just like a standard Mario game. You know, you jump, you have different power-ups. You actually get three different hats that you wear throughout the game. So Wario's basic attack is he has a shoulder charge and can also jump and, you know, like jump on enemies like you do in really any Mario game. But whenever you jump on an enemy, unless you do a, I mean, I'm just going to call it what it is. It's a butt stomp. you just stun your enemies. You don't defeat them because you have to do the shoulder charge in order to beat them.
Yeah.
So your three hats that you get, you have the bull helmet, which increases your strength, and also it doubles the length of distance you cover doing your shoulder charge attack. You can also smash through blocks more easily. So most, if you have your standard hat, it takes, you know, 2 hits with the shoulder charge to break a block. With the blue, the bull helmet is only 1. You also get the jet helmet, which allows you to glide, and you can also use it underwater, which is really cool because you can't do any attacks while you're underwater, but if you have the jet helmet, you can do the shoulder charge while you're underwater.
That's cool. Rampage then says, is there a cow launcher? If not, he doesn't know if he's interested.
Unfortunately, that's restricted to just South Park.
Oh.
But the third helmet is the dragon helmet, which essentially shoots fire. It negates your shoulder charge, like you can't do it whenever you have the dragon helmet. But the flames last, I think, like 5 to 7 seconds. So you can still use it and be fairly effective. You go through your various worlds. There's a boss at the end of every world. I think there's at least 6 or 7 sub-worlds to every area that you're at. Then you fight a boss, and you progress throughout the game.
So how long is this game? Because I know the Mario Land games are notoriously short.
It's slightly longer than Mario Land 2.
Okay.
If I remember correctly. I couldn't tell you like an estimated amount of hours that it takes to complete the game. But you can spend a good couple of days on this game. But a cool little thing, and this is a slight spoiler, but the game's, you know, almost 30 years old at this point. At the end of the game, you fight Captain Syrup, and she has a genie that you have to fight as well. And once you beat her, you gain control of the genie, and the genie's the one who ultimately gives you whatever your prize is at the end of the game. Because you give him whatever money you've collected, and he uses that to create your house or your castle or whatever the case may be. At the end of the game, you beat Captain Syrup, you find the giant golden statue, and sure enough, Mario flies in from out of nowhere, attaches the statue to his helicopter, waves at Wario, and flies away. And you're just like, son of a biscuit.
Just to be a dick.
I know. I'm like, Mario's the real villain of this game.
Yeah.
But all in all, like, this game is pretty straightforward. Like, there's not a ton of detail that I can say about it other than it's a really, really fun platforming game. I like all three of the Mario Land games. The first one is, you know, like, how do I say this? I won't say it's graphically inferior, but it's way different than 2 and 3.
Yeah.
Well, that's think what of you it said as like you... the Mario Brothers 1 and comparing it to 2 and 3.
Well, that's what you were saying when you played, when you reviewed 6 Golden Coins. You were saying how much of a graphical leap it was. And even I remember looking at the pictures and it was like, whoa, this game is way more advanced than Super Mario Land. Like, because it actually had the sprite of Mario from like, you know, the Super Mario World.
Almost like
World.
The Mario Brothers 3.
Yeah, Mario Brothers 3 sprite. I was like, wow, this looks so much better than the first one. The first one's really kind of bare bones. Or at least the screenshots that I saw were.
And it's not that long either. And I remember you talking about this when I reviewed Mario Land 1. I could not beat that game as a kid. I beat 2 and 3, but I could never beat 1. And then I went back and downloaded all three of them on the 3DS virtual console because Mixmaster mentions, I don't believe this is on the eShop. It is not. It is on the 3DS. If it's still active, you can get it from there. That's where I got it. That's where I've got Mario Land 1 and 2 as well.
Yeah, I'm not even sure if the 3DS eShop is even open anymore.
That's what I'm saying is that if it's still open, I'd recommend getting all three, to be honest. But if you're only going to get one, I would get this one. I do really like the second one because it's, I don't know, it's one of those little hidden gems of Mario that I feel like nobody really talks about.
Yeah.
And same thing with, you know, this game as well. I mean, this also launched a Wario Land series, which I believe there were three of those as well that were a lot of fun. Mm-hmm. But it has that Mario formula where it's still a platformer as your ultimate objective, but it adds enough new elements to it, like the fact that, yeah, you can jump, but that's not necessarily how you beat your enemies. It's not like jumping on a Goomba.
Yeah.
And he's dead. You know, you have to do a little bit more legwork. And the treasure element, to me, adds a lot to it. It adds replayability because you can just skim through the game if you want. Because it's kind of funny to see just like how little you get if you don't collect all the treasure.
Yeah.
But then it also motivates you to go through each level and find the various, you know, treasure chests. Because what you essentially do is you find hidden rooms that you have to have a key for. Because mm-hmm. If you find a key, you know that world has a treasure chest in it.
Sounds a lot like Goblin Sword.
A little bit, yeah. Minus the sword.
Yeah.
but it's still, it's as fun. Like, I would highly recommend this game. Like I said, it's, to me, pretty easily my favorite of the Mario Land trilogy. It's the one that I've played the most. You know, two is a lot of fun. I think one is good for what it is, but this has enough detail where you can go back and keep playing and try to do more. And,
yeah,
you know, even try and go through, because what I used to do is I would just go through the game the first time and just try and unlock everything. Because there are hidden worlds that, you know, like each world has, not each world, but some worlds have multiple paths or hidden paths. Mm-hmm. That lead to other levels that you go through. So it's trying to find those, and then I'll beat the game, and then I'll go back and try and find all the treasure.
Yeah, Axeblade just put up the link to the eShop. Apparently it's still there. So if you have a 3DS and you want to play this, it is still open in the eShop. And if you're in the chat room and you want to get this, just click on that link, and it'll take you right to it.
Yeah, Mixmaster says he's going to get it. Yeah. I think you'll like it.
See, I agree with Axeblade, like what he just put in there. Man, I wish Switch would get a virtual console feature like the Wii, 3DS, and Wii U. Why they haven't done it is still one of the biggest mysteries to me right now. I'm just like, why? We're 3 years into this console at this point, and you guys still haven't put a good eShop up there for all this retro stuff. It boggles my mind, man.
I agree. The Wii was easily the best virtual console mm-hmm. that Nintendo's ever done. The interface was super simple, mm-hmm. and it actually had a great amount of content on mm-hmm. it.
Yep.
So I don't know.
I mean, honestly, why. You know, if they had the eShop on the Switch and this was, I don't know, 99 cents, yeah, I'm going to drop 99 cents on this. Why wouldn't I?
Oh, for sure. I don't know why they won't do it.
I don't know. They hate money for some reason. I think because they have all the money already, they don't care.
Yep.
Yeah, I wish I still had my Wii, but I lost it in the divorce. So
I don't
have my Wii stuff anymore.
Yeah. Well, as far as the reception of this game goes, Game Informer's Ben Reeves called it the 13th best Game Boy game and called it the most successful spinoff from the Mario series. GamePro named it the best Game Boy game at the 1994 Consumer Electronics Show, praising the new power-ups and the multiple endings. In their latest review, they deemed the game faster, more challenging, and more fun than its handheld predecessors. They particularly commented that the backgrounds were not as cluttered as in the previous games, making the action easier to follow. Mm-hmm. That's one thing I'll say, too, is that it's a very, like, the sprites look good for a Game Boy, but the backgrounds are very, not necessarily bare bones. I call it, like, a very clean type of look, so you're not, like, distracted by the backgrounds. Mm-hmm. Not as detailed as Mario Land 2, but
I think we had a bump in the road here. Let me switch us over to Central. See what happens. Sorry, everybody. We had a glitch in Discord. Oh, come on, Discord. Yep, calling Derek back. Hold on, I'm going to pause real quick. I don't know what happened. Oh, no. Actually, I'm on speaking terms with that ex that had my Diablo game save, but I highly doubt she still has that computer. I mean, that was what, like, holy crap, that was like, that was 20 freaking years ago, man. That's crazy. Let me move back to south and see if that helps. Damn you, Discord. Oh, what was your first computer? Rampage? Mine was a Hewlett-Packard 486 back in like 94.
I think I'm back.
I see. You don't have a camera.
All right, stand by. That was weird.
Yeah, that would just completely just took a dump.
Yeah, because I lost connection to my OBS, too.
Really?
Yeah.
You must have had a... you must have had, like, a bump in your internet or something.
Yeah. Hang on a second.
A Tandy 500. Yeah, well, yeah, I think if you get technical, my very first computer was a Commodore 64.
All right, it's weird. It says my camera's working.
It's not.
You still don't see me?
No. Let me see. Can you see me?
Yes.
I mean, there's nothing I can do on my end other than just ending the call and calling you back. Want to try that?
Yeah, sure.
All right. There you are.
Yay. Oh, yeah. Boy. You gotta love technology.
Oh, yeah. Especially Discord. I don't know why Discord... Well, I don't know. It might have been your internet. Dude, I had like a little... just a power blip yesterday afternoon. Power went off for like a second. And then, of course, like everything just took forever to turn back on.
It was my internet.
I was starting to get worried about my computer, man. Like, after that power went out, I turned it back on. It took like 10 minutes for it to boot up. I was like, please.
Very much have a love-hate relationship with computers.
But yeah, Rampage, I had a Commodore 64, and I also had this book that was like 100 games you can program yourself. That me and my brother got for Christmas and like when I was a little kid. And I used to sit and program like simple games when I was a kid. Like I think I made Hangman and stuff like that. My grandpa used to program games for me too. And I don't know if you guys remember, if anybody that had the Commodore 64, that was a tape deck that you could just buy cassette tapes and put in there and you could save your games to the cassette tape. So my grandpa would write, like, he had, like, Snoopy, he had, like, a Snoopy game for me, like, a maze game. It was, like, a 3D maze game that he had for me. It was awesome. I loved my Commodore 64.
Nice.
But if you want, I'll go ahead and turn the, I'll hit unpause, and we can resume.
Yeah.
I don't remember where you were at, though.
I got it.
Okay. Here we go. In 3, 2, 1. And we're back. Sorry about that. Had a glitch in the matrix.
I took the red pill.
Yeah. I take the blue pill.
And you stay in Wonderland.
I stay in Wonderland, and this steak tastes juicy, and the matrix is telling my brain that this is turkey jerky.
Like you said in the matrix, ignorance is bliss.
Yeah.
But sorry about that little hiccup that my internet had. But no, I was just talking about the reception that Wario Land got. It was basically regarded as one of the best Game Boy games ever, and I would absolutely echo that sentiment. To me, it's probably top five best Game Boy game ever made, in my opinion. It's up there with Link's Awakening. I would put probably Metroid 2 up there as well. I really like that game as well. I would give this game, I'd say, a solid 8.5.
That's not bad for a Game
Boy title.
Is what
I would
give
this game.
Yeah.
As I mentioned, it's the best of the Mario Land trilogy, and it's cool because it sparked a whole new spin-off series from Mario, because it, you know, there were multiple Wario Land games after this. There was also the WarioWare microgame series, and all of that resulted from this game. So
when did this come out?
94.
Okay. Because when did Virtual Boy come out? Like 90? Let me check that real quick. Virtual Boy.
Not too long after that, because there was a Virtual Boy Wario Land game.
Yeah, I was going to say they had that Wario game. It was released.
That
came
out in 95.
95. So, yeah. I didn't know which one came first. I didn't know if it was the Game Boy game or the Virtual Boy game.
No, it was the Game Boy. Because then there was also three more Wario Land games after that. And then Wario Land Shake It, which I never played. But then you have the WarioWare Inc. series, which those games are a lot of fun, too. There's just these collections of, like, really quick games that you have, like, 5 seconds to complete that star Wario and several other characters that are introduced in that series. So
that's cool.
It's, yeah, Wario has had a pretty good run as a video game character.
Yeah, he's 26 years old at this point. I mean, yeah, he's... And isn't he in Smash Brothers? Yeah, he's got to be in Smash Brothers.
Yep. Yeah, he was introduced in Smash Brothers Brawl.
I was going to say, he's probably been in there a while.
Yeah, so Wario, like, not a lot of people really talk about Wario, but he's had some pretty decent staying power when it comes to a video game character.
Seems like he's due for a comeback.
Man, if you were to make some type of, like, a 3D Wario platformer, I'd play it. In a heartbeat.
Yeah, I would too.
Wario Land 3D. Make it happen, Nintendo.
Yeah, come on, Nintendo. Metroid first. Concentrate on Metroid. Get Metroid. You know, give us Metroid. Then you bring out the Wario. Because, you know.
Yeah.
Well, first, you got to give us the Mario 35th anniversary, whatever you're going to do there. Give us Metroid, and then you can give us Wario. And we'll
Which
be
I
in.
Heard might be delayed until next year.
And Breath of the Wild 2. You can go ahead and give me Breath of the Wild. I'm ready.
I want that game to come out, but I don't, because I know whenever it does, I'm just going to spend so much time playing it.
Well, I hope it when it does come out, it's a Christmas release. That way I can spend my Christmas vacation like I did last time. That's how I put so many hours into Breath of the Wild, because I got my Nintendo Switch. It was a Christmas present to myself, and I bought Breath of the Wild. And of course, I get 2 weeks off for Christmas, so that's all I did for two straight weeks was play Breath of the Wild from morning to night.
What I'm likely going to do, like if that game doesn't come out during baseball season, I'm going to probably take at least 2 to 3 days off of work, and that's what I'm going to do.
Yeah. Yeah, come on, Nintendo. That mixed master.
Come on, Nintendo.
They don't like our money, man. I don't know what the hell. Dude, I haven't been in Animal Crossing. Because Rampage says you need to get Animal Crossing because he has a toy wrestler waiting for you. I have a couple of those around my little house.
Rampage is going to talk me into getting it.
Yeah, I built
How do I turn down a gift?
I built a wrestling arena on my island.
Was it you or Wally that sent that video?
It was Wally, because I built mine, and then I was going to have people come to my island and just check it out, and then I stopped playing, and that was like a month ago. I haven't been on Animal Crossing for like a month. I had to just step away for a moment, because that game was sucking my life away.
So many turnips waiting for you.
Yeah. Dude, I got mad, too, with the last time I got turnips. Because I bought turnips Well, there was a week that I missed it because I woke up late, and turnips on my island for one of those days were like $500-something per turnip. I'm like, damn it. So I bought turnips the next week. It was like below what I paid for them. I was like, this sucks. So I ended up like having rotten turnips by Sunday. And then so I bought some. And then, no, that week I was like, well, I'm not doing turnips anymore. And then like a day later, my turnips went back up to like $600. I'm like, screw this turnip shit.
I didn't know the turnip game was so like cutthroat.
Yeah, man. It's like playing the stock market. And that's what it is in the game. They call it the turnip market.
Sounds like a surefire way to get your Animal Crossing character killed.
Yeah.
There's going to be some type of scandal.
Yeah.
Dude, if I could do any type of computer animation and I wouldn't get sued, I would totally make a gangster film set in the Animal Crossing universe.
Oh, that'd be cool.
And have it be like the catalyst would be some type of like a turnip catastrophe.
Mixmaster says he's never played an Animal Crossing game. Well, I can say I never did either and never got the appeal of it. It always just seemed too cutesy for me until I got it for the Switch. The only reason I got it was because everybody was talking about it and we were in the middle of quarantine. So I was like, you know what? I'm just going to go ahead and get this game, see what all the hype is. And it sucked me in like crack. And I couldn't stop playing it. And then like 4 months go by and I'm just like, yep, I got to stop playing this damn game.
Rampage asks, have you guys seen that video of Africa by Toto?
Yes, I've seen that video.
I have not.
Yeah, because in the game, you can actually, there's this little guy, KK Slider. He's a little dog that comes in and plays music. He's like the pop star of the Animal Crossing world. And then on your island, you can actually do a tune for your your island or whatever. And you could easily, like, if once you learn the notes, you could make pretty much any song you want in there and be like your island tune. So a lot of people go in there and make songs and stuff. And because KK Slider, he's like, I don't know if you've ever heard the language used in Animal Crossing, but he doesn't say words. He sings, but he's like, and they just do that kind of stuff and make him sing like Africa and like all kind of different songs. It's pretty cool, actually.
I'll have to check that out.
Don't get sucked in, Derek. Don't get sucked in.
I know, like, that's the reason why, like, I kind of don't want to play it, because I know when I do, like, I'm done.
Yeah.
I have a very addictive personality when it comes to games. That's why I'm so selective with like the new games that I play. It's pretty much restricted to like Zelda and Smash Brothers.
And it's one of those games that's like, it's so relaxing because there's no like game to it. It's like Chores the video game, like I've said before, where you just go in there and you clean up your island and you talk to your people and you plant your trees and your flowers and, you know, you go harvest all your stuff and you sell things and you collect shells and, like, you dig up fossils and you fill up your museum with all these, you know, giant dinosaur, you know, skeletons. And, like, it's just one of those things, like, I can't stop playing this damn game. And it's not even a game. Oh, shit. Oh, Rampage says Jess wants me to repeat my KK Slider impersonation. All it is like...
Oh, that's good.
I'm going to have to cut that out of the podcast.
I think that should be the new sound clip you play at the end of each episode.
Yeah, that'd be great. Let's go ahead and get out of here. This is the end of the show. Before we go, anything else you would like to throw out there? How's the Derek Diamond Experience doing?
Yeah, so I've got a new episode coming out. Well, actually, it'll be out when you guys hear this on the download. New episodes come out every Thursday on all podcasting platforms. You can follow me on social media @DDiamondPodcast. One cool thing that I got to do, I believe it was last week. It might have been the week before. I don't know. The days all kind of blend together at this point. So there's a new podcast that's based here in Pensacola called Fantastic People, mm-hmm. where they interview people based on their fandoms of certain things. And I was a guest on their show, and my interview will be released this week. So if you want to hear me talk about podcasting, and I got to actually tell a little bit of like my, I don't want to call it my life story, but a little bit of my background and everything, and like why I started podcasting. And, you know, I talked about us starting this show and starting my show and various things like that. So just search for Fantastic People. That's on all podcasting platforms too. I believe that episode will be out this upcoming Friday.
Okay.
So definitely check that out. And then got some cool things, as I mentioned earlier, planned for my show, including some horror-themed shows in October. Going to be doing some other roundtables, you know, in the coming weeks. So
should be
some fun times.
Tomorrow on Open Micers, which you can join us right here on my Twitch channel at 7 p.m. Central, we are going to have on Jared Seymour, who is not only the singer in my band Falls from Grace, but he's got two great podcasts. One is called Brownwater Banter, which is basically like covers all kind of like businesses and basically life on the Gulf Coast. And he has another one called The Sound, which plays music from all kind of unsigned bands from, you know, the Southeastern region. And they have some great shows. They've put on concerts, which were getting pretty big before COVID hit. We would have had a whole summer full of concerts if it wasn't for freaking disease. And but go check out The Sound. I think it's thesound228.com and also Brownwater Banter Podcast. And go check those shows out. And he's going to be on tomorrow night at 7 p.m. And go check out not only our Patreon here for this show, if you like this show. Derek's got his Patreon now for the Derek Diamond Experience. What's the address for that one?
Patreon.com/DDiamondPodcast.
And then also we have one for the Open Micers, which is Patreon.com/OMPodcast. And yeah, I think that's about it. Oh, if you want to join our Discord community, just go check out our Twitter and Facebook, and we will, if we can remember, we're going to at least once or every day or so, we're going to put that link up there for the Nerd Cave Retro Discord, where you can hang out with all us cool people like Rampage and Mixmaster and Axeblade and Bethany Fox and everybody else that hangs out in our Discord. And it's one of the greatest social networks I've ever been a part of because nobody's a dick. And I love being in there. But yeah, that's about it. You know, is there anything else we need to do before we leave?
No, I think that's
it. It's been 2 weeks. I'm trying to end the show and I can't forget. I forgot how. All right, let me get our music here before I embarrass myself any further. If you would like to email us, you can email us at nerdcaveretro@gmail.com. We are at nerdcaveretro.com. We're on Instagram and Twitter, at nerdcaveretro. Also individually at jfunktastic and at Derek_diamond. We're at Facebook at facebook.com/nerdcaveretro. And, of course, our Patreon at patreon.com/nerdcaveretro. Where if you throw us a couple bucks a month, we can keep above that $50 level, not only to pay the dues for this show, because it's not free for us, it's free for you, it's not free for us. So help us keep the lights on and keep us above that $50 level where we do the commentary tracks every month. And the next one we got coming up is Mortal Kombat for this month. And Derek, one more thing, leave a review if you can't leave us a buck a month. So Derek, please tell them what it's all about.
This is the way.
Yes.
I have spoken.
I was trying to find it. I forgot where it was on the...
I was hoping you'd play that
on the soundboard. I was like, where is it? Thank you, guys. Thanks for hanging out with us tonight.
Yeah.
It felt a little rusty going into the show. I mean, even taking 2 weeks off, it's like, damn, how do we do this again?
Sometimes 2 weeks can feel like 2 months.
Let's see, what is this, 192? 192. Yep. Damn, that was an hour and 15 minutes.
Chunky show.
Oh, yeah, X-Blade
says the Street Fighter movie commentary was great.
Yeah, I listened to it at work the other day. Just went back and listened to it. I was like, man, this is a funny commentary.
Yeah.
Especially the whole, meanwhile, meanwhile in Mortal Kombat. It just kept coming out of nowhere. Right when you thought we were done with it, we would bring it back up. That was my favorite part.
There'd be like 3 or 4 seconds of silence. Yeah. Meanwhile.
It was so good.
Yeah.
All right, guys.
I love the commentary tracks.
I'm going to go ahead and end the stream now because I got to get going and edit this thing and upload it. So thank you guys for hanging out tonight. And be here tomorrow night, 7 o'clock for Open Micers. Good night, guys.